Donc bonjour à tous, c'est une
Greetings to all. This is an introductory sequence that will tell you about two major issues. On the one hand, the problem of the exhaustion of resources, and on the other hand, how the use of these resources can modify the great biochemical cycles on Earth. First of all, growth induces a use, an increasing use of resources, and of course the world is finite, and the use of these resources will become limited. After the war, people thought that the limitations of the Earth were sufficient, but over the past few decades, we have understood that these limitations would be reached relatively soon. And one major resource is fossil fuel, such as oil. And in particular, what a number of forecasts have been made to try and determine how the resource would be limited in the future. So these forecasts here, you can see them on the graph. We looked at how production of oil was going to change, and you can see a typical bell graph here with a production maximum and then a gradual and irremediable decline as the resource becomes exhausted. There's not only oil, of course. There are also phosphates. Phosphates are involved in the production of fertilizer and therefore in farming yields. It's extremely important to feed the world. And there, a number of forecasts have been made, and the phosphorus should be exhausted relatively soon. So I talked about non-renewable resources, but the question also arises for renewable resources. When they are used faster than their capacity to regenerate. For instance, fish. You can see here a graph that shows the evolution in fishing over time, and you have this characteristic curve with a peak which has already been reached in the 1970s, and now there is a drop in fishery productivity. Another important resource, biodiversity. You can see here that there is an erosion of biodiversity for both terrestrial and marine ecosystems, which leads some to say that we have reached the sixth major extinction period because of this quick erosion of biodiversity. So the use of these resources is going to lead to disturbances of major cycles, particularly the combustion of fossil fuels produces large amounts of CO2 in the atmosphere, and this CO2, which is an inert gas, accumulates in the atmosphere. You can see here on this graph that shows the evolution of CO2 over time. There was a very powerful increase, and now we have reached more than 400 parts per million of CO2 in the atmosphere. So, of course, there's not only CO2, there are other compounds that are going to change over time: methane, nitrous oxide, and various other concentrations are going to be rising in the air. So the question is, how can you make the connection between what is emitted and what actually really ends up in the atmosphere? If you look at this graph here, there are two sources of CO2 emissions, essentially. On the one hand, fossil fuels, which are increasing, the use is increasing constantly over time, and then the change in land use, and in particular deforestation, which releases the carbon that was stored in the biomass in the form of CO2. It also accumulates in the atmosphere, but here you can see that it's relatively constant over time, although not negligible. So if you look at the growth of the presence of CO2 in the atmosphere, the evolution is chaotic. The emissions change continuously while their accumulation in the atmosphere is more chaotic, and it is in fact much slower than the emissions themselves. So in truth, there's only about half of our emissions that end up in the atmosphere. And that can be linked to the fact that we are fortunate enough to have two great carbon reserves on the one hand, vegetation on the other hand, the oceans, and they store part of the carbon that we emit, about half of the carbon. And there are quite large differences, because you can see that the ocean sink is relatively continuous, but for vegetation, things vary extremely from one year to another, and that pretty much depends on the weather, on the climate. So is this sink, will these biospheric sinks persist as climate change occurs? So some people may say, if you look at the story, the history of the Earth's climate, there are CO2 concentrations that have changed significantly over time. But it's not just the issue of the quantity, there's also the issue of time. These graphs here show the evolution of the atmosphere's composition thanks to air bubbles that are stored in ice. We can trace the composition of the atmosphere over thousands of years. And what can be seen is that if you're on the geological scale, the phenomena of our time are extremely fast. We have CO2 here, nitrous oxide, and methane. And you can see that the evolution is extremely fast. And of course, that's very important, because in the long run, there can be an adaptation of the system. But in the shorter run, the system does not have time to adapt to change. So I presented these three gases because they have properties. They are so-called greenhouse gases. They let the sun's ray pass through, but they trap the infrared radiation from the surface. So they accumulate energy in the system. Additional energy is what is known as radiative forcing. And that is what you can see here. And you see that it increased markedly in recent years. And that is actually going to modify the temperature. You have an evolution of the average temperature. You can see here significant increases. Temperature has risen by almost 1 degree Celsius, and in fact this spread is not homogeneous across space. The temperature increase is much higher on continents than over water. So there is on the one hand the exhaustion of resources, and the resources which we use disturb the entire system, the great geochemical cycles, and also the climate of the Earth itself, and there will be consequences on the cycles themselves.